thing for our nation is so, you know, strategic. In my profile, you heard about my mission. I want our workforce to be a competitive outfit for that, you know, group of people to be able to generate income our country needs, for us to be able to achieve economic independence, economic renaissance, economic development for the country, for them to be able to offer the right quality of life for 21 million people in Sri Lanka. Why am I saying it's so strategic? We have an HR strategy by default, one can say by design as well, where we have a practice of exporting unskilled labor. We export housewives, carpenters, plumbers, you know, the kind of people we export. And you also know what we're importing from other countries. CEOs, senior managers. Of course, in the recent past, we also have seen another trend where at the grassroots level, people entering, and a laborer, Sri Lankan laborer, charges anything between 1,500 rupees to 2,000 rupees. But when these guys come from India, Bangladesh, and various other countries, you know, they are willing to work for 600, 700 rupees. But that being another issue, the first issue I talked about, exporting unskilled labor and importing CEOs and senior managers, is suicidal. And when we export carpenters and plumbers, each person would bring in about 40 to 50,000 rupees a month. And any idea as to how much a CEO working for a multinational or a local company takes out on a monthly basis? Any guesses? You heard in my profile that I was the president of American Chamber of Commerce. And I have had access to a lot of information. And with who I am, what I am, I have access to current information as well. Any guesses? It's important before I tell you how, why personal branding is important. 3 million rupees a month. A leading professional is saying it.
You see, this guy who was a friend of mine, and who was the CEO of the Huawei. 10 million rupees. Plus everything, accommodation.
So, this asset is something we need to use strategically. We need to get out of this mess we are in. Where have we failed? And that's the topic today. Though it sounds branding, there's a lot more than branding in the topic I've chosen today. Right? So, with that, let me move on. Okay, so you're all, you know, working. Maybe you have your own businesses as well, some of you. World is becoming a much harder place to live. And if we want success, we go to compete. Without competition, you cannot think of success. Right? So we go to compete. Whether you like it or not, we go to compete. But we will talk about Sri Lankan attitudes and all that later on. But just take a look at some of the things I put down here. I talked about some of the global challenges that are shown underneath in that one line. Short economic cycles. Economic, you know, boom, recession, recovery. Is that the cycle? Yes. Mr. Economist, right? So, you know, we used to have long cycles, but today, we don't know. I mean, today, some, you know, people are talking about another recession just about, you know, the world, right? So whatever, so in that, in terms of job security, we have a huge issue, right? There was a time when, you know, one enters an organization, eyes closed, you know, you are there until you retire. Is that the situation now? No. So you've got to keep marketing yourself every 5 years or every 10 years, whether we like it or not, right? So that's the environment in which we live. decreasing job tenures, which is what I talked about. Downsizing affects people with low perceived value first. Just read that twice. Getting into your system is all about that, that I'm going to, you know, talk to you this evening. The oil companies are doing pretty bad. I work for an oil company, me and Mahishni, and this is the worst time to be in this industry, right? So the top five oil companies are talking about restructuring. It's a nice word to use. It's all about chasing people away, eliminating people, retrenching, right? The term uses restructuring sounds beautiful, right? But the reality is that you're laying off people. So the five top oil companies globally will reduce their staff by minimum 30% over the next 1 year to 1.5 years time. The plans are underway. Some organizations have already started on it, and some are, you know, planning for it, and it will happen. Compete globally for local jobs. Isn't that the case now? We're going to compete globally for local jobs. We have foreign CEOs coming and, you know, holding the key positions in local organizations. Right? I don't want to mention names, too sensitive, but that's the fact. Right? So as I said at the beginning, some of these guys take, 10 million rupees out of this country on a monthly basis. Right? Family accommodation in Colombo 7, two vehicles, children's education, business class traveling every 3 months. You add everything up, 10 million. Right? So shift from work locally to work anywhere. That's another trend. Careers are no longer managed by organizations, but by individuals themselves. The organizations may use very nice jargons, words, statements, all of that. But the moment you see no value being realized by you, organizations will not want you. They will want you to be out of that organization, which is not spoken about, or spoken about in different words. The reality remains that the moment you stop delivering value to the organization, you are discarded. You are not wanted anymore. So you got to manage your own thing. And a lot of companies talk about development, all of that, training. There was a time in Sri Lanka where companies made investments to help individuals to achieve their career aspirations. Organizations don't do that today. Can't. Not any other reason. Organizations will develop you for you to be able to deliver greater value for the organization today, not for your career. Forget it. Companies will say it, but I know they don't mean what they say. So it's good for us to, you know, realize, you know, all these realities, understand these realities so that we know how to respond to it. Hey, I'm setting the stage, right? Moving away from job hunting to being hunted, right? In the modern world, with the level of competition, with all the new, you know, practices and all that, if you're good, you'll be hunted by others. We have reached that level already in Colombo. Prospects are Googled. So if you're not present in Google, you will not be demanded anymore. So you have to make sure that you do things differently, do big enough things, excel in some area for you to be able to have your story in the net. If you don't have it, you're not marketing yourself. Okay, so you know, we have conventional thinking as a nation. Competition is a bad word culturally. Our parents never told us compete. They told us be a good citizen, right? without realizing the fact that if you are not commercially successful, that you can't be a good citizen. So I suggest to people that this is the truth, right? But that being our conventional thinking, how we have thought, how we have approached competition, we have actually competed. Right? These are some of the examples. We have product brands, service brands, you know, all of that. And some of the other things. You know, your parents probably, to prepare you to be able to face competition, may have used addresses close to good schools, and you may have done it for your kids as well if you are married and having kids. So we don't talk about competing or competition, but we have actually done it. So I'm saying, be honest about it. Make a conscious decision to compete. Compete, but compete ethically in a socially responsible manner. And when you succeed, don't limit the benefits of, you know, success just to yourself. Right? Let everybody benefit out of it. And competing on that basis is definitely not a bad thing to do. And if you are to create that you know, economy for our people to be able to live the quality of life they deserve, we have to compete as a nation. We have to compete as a nation. We need to create wealth for the country. And that is an action for the people. So if you're not told to compete, if you're not trained to compete, and we don't have that attitude, we will never be able to achieve economic independence. Forget about it. Right? So, I mean, schools, and, you know, we have always wanted better houses. You know, your house has to look better than your neighbor's house. You want to drive a four-wheel, which is, you know, not from India, but from Japan. And if the neighbor is driving a Japan vehicle, you want something from Europe. Haven't we done it? Don't we actually understand? Can't we relate to that? So we are competing, and we have competed, right? And to get the right partners as well, right? Rajit, are you still competing?
Yeah.
And real competition as well. So today the topic is about personal branding, right? But branding goes much beyond that, right? Schools are brands as well. Getting O-level from Kataragum Mahavidyalaya versus getting O-levels from a branded school are two different things. Which is more demand? But product is the same. What is the difference? If a child going to Kataragum Mahavidyalaya, you know, gets a C for maths, and a royal boy, you know, getting a C for maths, quality is the same. Product is the same. But there is a difference in demand. So that is because there are brands, right, operating silently. And even some of the religious places. I'm a Buddhist, so I use my own examples. Right? Going to Narada Malika versus going to another thing. Religiously, if you use religious principles, of course one can say, you know, that's where truth really is, you know, kept. So therefore, it's different, but I'm just trying to, you know, argue about the point. HSBC, we have a guy from HSBC. You should pay me something for using your, right? So you can probably quote a figure. Huh? Make sure that you get the check from me. Right? So versus going to Sanasa Bank, you may have an account with Sanasa Bank for good reasons, but you don't want to talk about it outside, right? But if you have an account with HSBC, we'll give it a heck of a lot of publicity. Okay, so let me move on. How does personal branding help you? This is already known, but it creates a unique identity for you. You're known, recognized, admired, and respected. It creates a greater confidence and desire to perform. That naturally taps into your innate capacity, your inner capacity. And that delivers greater results. So with that, what you get is recognition, respect, admiration, and then obviously you will have benefits following you as well. That offers you a better quality of life, and that gives you self-satisfaction and esteem association. See how it is linked to real life. Right? Any disagreements? When you are known, when you are respected, when you are admired, some of you are there already, feeling is fabulous. That's all about living. Fine. Ajit, you agree? Right? When you're known for creating value, right? That feeling is the ultimate an individual, a human being can have. So when you become a brand, when you see others admiring you, respecting you, you wouldn't want to let that go. And to stay there, you'll work harder and smarter, more intelligently. With more competition coming in, you look at elevating yourself. Right? So look at the commercial aspect of that as well, when you keep rising. Okay, so again, a little bit of theory. For the same reason I told you, personal brand structure. So you have a core brand, you have augmented, created brand, perceived brand. That's what you're talking about, right? It's about creating an identity that is unique, consistent, and I've underlined the word memorable. It's all about sitting there, right? It's not external, it's here in your target audience. So that's what you're going to achieve. And obviously, personal brand is one that you own and can be proud of. Okay, so I told you that I'll be using real individuals. So these are different structures you can see in the real world. Right? So some have huge core. So their product is so far superior. Product is huge. Tangible value is enormous, but augmented value, perceived emotional value, for some, very small, very thin. And for some, look at this example here, core is only so much, they've augmented it with different things to be able to create a demand. Whether they can sustain or otherwise is your own judgment. So look at this. Individuals, and you know, see where you want to plot them, right? Within this world, I've dealt with all the politicians, literally all the known leading politicians in the country. Shihan Mirang, the first.
First superstar, obviously.
I mean, he came to the. Yeah, whatever. Okay, so I don't want to share my judgment with you, but I'll share with you some real stories. And I work with all these people, and you heard in my profile that I'm sitting on the board of Sinister Foundation, the foundation that does Vidirag, you know what I'm talking about. So I work with all the cinema artists. And I'm also sitting on the board of Oscar Foundation, which is the foundation for the music industry in Sri Lanka. So I work with Pandit Amaradeva to Shihan Mirang to all of them. So I know in and out of everything, but I'm not going to talk about any personal information. But there was a time when Shihan Mihirang used to charge 500,000 rupees to come and perform. And Pandit Amardeva could only fetch 100,000 rupees. Now, Pandit Amardeva's emotional value is enormous because he can't sing. and people simply love him. They deal with that. So he comes, he sings, he makes a mistake, the audience applaud for making, for trying to sing. If you haven't experienced that in the recent past, when the next show happens, go experience that, beautiful, right? And I do that every week, so therefore I know. So see the comparison, right? So it was a halo this guy managed to create, right? That gave him 500,000 rupees when Pandit Amardev was such a quality product, national asset, could fetch only 100,000. Manly Fonseca versus the lady at the bottom, right? Manly Fonseca's acting versus multifaceted young lady. Thank God she is not in the country. The demand, the skills, the talents, all of that. Two individuals here, I don't talk much, and I believe Dr. Sarath Amulugama is not marketing himself. I told you I have dealt with, you know, so many presidents, you know, from President Premadasa up to the current president. I have had personal interactions with all of them, and you know, I've worked with so many leading politicians as well. In my view, Dr. Sarath Amulugama should be the one who should be providing the leadership to this country. My personal opinion. Okay? But is he a successful politician? Judgment is yours. Right? He couldn't even win one election, right? Right? Last or previous one. Superman with the right vision for the country, so much knowledge, strategist, but execution, and becoming a successful politician, to be able to beat the others, to be seen as the number one politician in the country. This is my personal opinion, right?